This is Deepak, and today I'm in London and on my way to New York. And I thought I'd share a few thoughts with you. So this morning when I was going through social media, I came across a lovely video by Professor Brian Cox from England, who's a cosmologist. And it was actually quite lovely. Dr. Cox has the ability to take complex scientific ideas in cosmology and quantum mechanics and make them relatable to all of us. So first of all, thank you, Dr. Cox, Brian Cox. So here is what I learned from the video, or a couple of videos this morning. That current cosmology is almost certain that the universe began with the Big Bang about 13.8 billion years ago. However, the cause of the Big Bang is not known, or why it happened when it happened. Also, there's something called cosmic inflation, where the universe tripled in size every trillionth of a trillionth of a trillionth of a second, and then slowed down. So it moved from the size of a dot, a period at the end of a sentence, to the size of a grapefruit in that period, cosmic inflation. And then it continued to expand, but at a slower rate. So right now, the cosmic horizon is over 48 billion light years away from where we are, because of the cosmological constant, etc. So the cause of cosmic inflation and the precision of that mathematically is not known. Also, there's a period called the Planck epoch, 10 to the power of minus 43 seconds post time zero. And during that period, there are no laws of physics. Also, it's not known why laws of physics exist. So, you know, as I was watching this video, I also remembered an email that I had received from a prominent physicist. I'm trying to recall his name, at Princeton, one of the only living contemporary physicists of Einstein's time, and Freeman Dyson. And Freeman Dyson, in an email that I received some time ago before he passed on, said that there were three riddles that he had been confounded by all his life. Number one, a universe fine-tuned for mind and life. Number one. Number two, our own consciousness. And number three, the unpredictable. He didn't say random, but unpredictable movement of particles. He said he didn't know the answer to these riddles, but he thought they were somehow connected. I thought that was brilliant. I wanted to share with you. So then I was also watching this video of Professor Cox. Maybe it was another one where he spoke about life beginning on our planet about 2.8 billion years ago in probably volcanic thermal vaults deep inside, under the sea in the ocean, several miles under the ocean, where there was the appropriate, temperature and environment for molecules to arrange themselves in such a way that maybe DNA was created. So lots of very interesting theories, but here is my response to all these theories. You cannot come up with these theories or even name elements, carbon, hydrogen, oxygen, nitrogen, or name force fields, or come up with hypotheses, unless before you do that, there is some experience or some mode of knowing in consciousness. And that mode of knowing, of course, is filtered through the conditioned human mind and by the limitations of the human brain. So even that which we call an empirical fact, let's take a Higgs boson, that's a species-specific perceptual snapshot. And by the time you actually locate it, measure it, whatever, it doesn't exist. In fact, by the time you measure anything, it doesn't exist. We're only measuring the past. Doesn't matter on a time scale of a few microseconds or eons, billions of light years. What we perceive, what we measure, even as empirical facts, cosmic wave background, is a very species-specific mode of knowing that requires, first of all, the human brain. But even the mode of knowing is influenced by scientific bias. An empirical fact is not measure of truth. It's just what we can perceive with all these very complicated instruments that we create as well. And then we give names to modes of knowing and experience. Higgs boson. Higgs is the name of a physicist. Boson actually was related to Bose, another Indian physicist. So, you know, these are names given to modes of knowing and experience. And therefore, I think unless we actually can explain consciousness, then no theory is valid, no matter what the empirical facts are. No theory is valid. And just to remind ourselves once again, that scientific method or the scientific discipline is also conceived in consciousness. Experiments are done in consciousness. Observations are made in consciousness. And all of them have limitations of knowing as well, the human brain and the conditioned human brain, whether it's conditioned by the scientific method or mathematics, which remains a mystery, why it's so effective, it doesn't matter. So scientific conditioning actually is in the mind. And it's a very useful discipline, because without that, I wouldn't be able to talk to you right now on the internet or do any of the things that we do or take for granted. Flying in planes, intergalactic probes, all these observatories in space, and all the amazing technology that has now emerged, including artificial intelligence. And of course, the technology that we're using right now to communicate, and the next phase of our technology, Web3. So science is an amazing gift that has evolved, let's say, in the human mind and human consciousness. Two separate things, by the way. Consciousness is not really human. Consciousness is not species specific. Awareness is the fundamental ground of all experience, but then the mind is species specific, and the mind is also, you know, culture specific and biased by our theories, and including our scientific theories. So unless we know the origins of consciousness, and unfortunately my colleagues, scientific colleagues, philosophical colleagues, neuroscientists, still think of consciousness as an emergent phenomenon, not as something that is irreducible, that is fundamental, that is without cause, that is formless, that is infinite, and that is modifying itself as the activities we in humans we call mind, intellect, ego, and then modes of knowing and observation, and then labeling our observations which occur in consciousness, reifying them as concrete objects out there, and then developing methodologies to study this. So when we realize this, then I think it's obvious that these amazing theories that Dr. Brian Cox, colleagues like Sean Carroll, and many others, including Dr. Wilczek, all these people have come up with amazing models for explaining the history of creation of the universe and how the universe functions. But let's keep reminding ourselves that models of reality are not reality. In fact, we don't even perceive the world directly as it is, because our perception is always filtered through the conditioned human mind. And all we do is make mental models and of what we think reality is. And these mental models, including space, time, causality, are mental models created by human beings and modes of knowing and experience that are given names: carbon, hydrogen, gravity, force fields, electromagnetism, are names given to human modes of knowing and experience and labeled as objective reality. But these are not, cannot be objective reality. Space-time, causality, particles, force fields cannot be objective reality. They are human constructs. And it's very important to recognize that, that human constructs cannot access truth with the capital T, reality. Impossible. Unless we transcend the mind, then we have access to this field of possibilities, the superposition of possibilities, unpredictability, non-local correlation, and the source of all experience. So I would like to propose that we need a consciousness-based science. And once we do that, then all these conundrums will be easier. Not that we will be able to solve the mystery of our existence or even the awareness of the mystery of our existence. So that's the issue here. Why embrace this new idea of consciousness and cosmos as complementarities? Well, because it'll expand our ability to do science and get us closer to truth. Fundamental truth is inaccessible to the human mind because of the limitations of the human mind. Now, this also leads to actually something that is very much part of yoga. I've spoken in the past on yamas and niyamas, but let's go to the last niyama, which is Ishwar Pranidhana, surrender to mystery. So this is what I like to propose, that actually, if we take time to do nothing and allow consciousness to be as awareness, as part of our experience, shift from perceptual activity, cognitive ability, transcend all that, and make pure consciousness as our reference point, then in the mere witnessing of form and phenomena, there is a deeper understanding and a spontaneous evolution that gives us insight, intuition, and some kind of creative insight and imagination that brings us closer to truth. And that involves great humility, surrender to mystery. A lot of scientists have that, by the way, the mystery and the sense of wonder, but they forget to ask, what is it that wonders? What is it that is mystified? What is it that wants to know? And of course, it's you. It's me. But me not as a body-mind, me in, as the awareness in which the body-mind, ego, intellect, and its perceptual activity are a unified activity that is constantly evolving into deeper understanding. So I think we need to revise Darwin. And I know when I say this, I risk being vilified, burnt at the stake, metaphorically speaking. But it's obvious that random mutations, we could say unpredictable mutations, but not random. Random mutations, natural selection, or the impermanent appearance of virtual particles as determined by the uncertainty principle, don't really explain reality or how we know reality. Because without even wanting to know reality, reality is inaccessible. The mystery of existence, not just the mystery of existence, it's also the awareness of mystery of existence. So when I look at the yamas and niyamas, I see the first ahimsa, peace presence, because when your mind is disturbed, it corrupts every mode of knowing. So ahimsa, first yama, and the last niyama, Ishwar pranidhana, surrender to mystery of existence, but also surrender to the mystery of the awareness of existence. Existence is a mystery, but even more mysterious is awareness of the mystery of existence. I hope to share this video with Drs. Brian Cox, with Dr. Frank Wilczek, with others who have postulated these theories, including Sean Carroll and the multiverse and string theories, Michio Kaku, and see what their response is. Through dialogue, we can all learn from each other. Okay, my friends, that's it for now. All the best from England, London. I'm on my way to New York now after having a fantastic pilgrimage in the Himalayas and also a period of silence.